My name is Eric Giordano, and I am the director of the Wisconsin Institute, otherwise known as WIPPS. And tonight, we're fortunate to have a wonderful panel of local faith community leaders from central Wisconsin and a wonderful moderator who will keep tonight's discussion on track. Founded in 2007, the Wisconsin Institute for Public Policy and Service is a unit of the UW Colleges and UW Extension. Our mission is to address local, state, and national issues by linking public scholarship, civic outreach, and student service to enhance community life throughout Wisconsin. We believe that the strength of American democracy in the 21st century depends on the engagement of citizens, residents, and communities in making decisions about issues that matter to them. This is public work in that we promote and build capacity for work by the public for public purposes. To that end, WIPPS' task is to provide resources, information, and ideas to empower the people and communities of Wisconsin. Now, tonight's forum would not be possible without the hard work of our planning team, which includes all those on the stage, as well as a number of others contributing quite a bit, actually, to this event, including Associate Professor of Psychology Marlo Embry, Program Manager Gail Kell, Deb Dorhorst, Connie Nicolai, Alex Sawaya, Jacob Simon, and we are also grateful for technical support from our theater technician, Chris Berg. We'd also like to thank our interns who are here tonight, and you hopefully saw them on the way in, and you'll see them on the way out. We'd also like to thank those anonymous donors who helped us donated money to help this event go forward. Unfortunately, we're still short the funds necessary to break even on tonight's program. Sadly, because of cuts to the university, WIPPS no longer has public funding. So for every program we do, we are now a cost recovery operation. So if after watching tonight's program, you're inspired, moved, pleased, or otherwise enjoyed the event, we encourage you to donate even a small amount. The collection plate will be available on the way out. You can also donate at WIPPS.org online. You'll also note that we have created a handout with a set of six questions, six or seven, I can't remember now, that are animating tonight's events, along with answers to each of these questions that were written by members of the faith communities represented on stage tonight. I want to acknowledge that we obviously do not have room for all faiths on the stage or in our question and answer handout. This was in part due to the group of people who organized the event. It was just happened to be the group that came to WIPPS. And some hard decisions based on our own capacity limitations. I note, for example, that my own faith tradition is not represented on stage, so please know that we're not intending to slight any particular faith community. And in fact, WIPPS is certainly open to doing future events with other faith groups. And so if representatives of other faiths would like to provide answers to the six questions tonight, you are welcome to share them with us at www.wips.org, and we'll happily provide a link to your website or post those questions. I will note that one community member came to us and said, you know, I'd like to, you know, have my questions registered, and we didn't have time to put them, mix them with the six, but she is Kay Sorensen, and she's from the Baha'i faith. She's got her hand raised in white right here. She has six questions answered from her faith tradition, so if you'd like to get those, she'll be happily hand those to you. It is now my pleasure to introduce the man who's largely responsible for organizing tonight's event. He proposed the idea and helped bring the planning group together. Reverend David Klutterman is pastor of St. John's Episcopal Church in Wausau. Father Klutterman has been a pastor of St. John's for 19 years after having served congregations in Manitowoc and the North Woods prior to coming to Wausau. He was ordained a priest in 1980 and served in the Diocese of Fond du Lac. He graduated from General Theological Seminary in New York City also in 1980. Since arriving in Wausau, Father Klutterman has been active in helping organize activities among downtown churches in Wausau, has served as an occasional instructor for Storefront Alternative High School, served as a consultant in education and formation around the Episcopal Church. He's married with three children and three grandchildren. It's my pleasure to welcome Father David Klutterman. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome. And thank you to WIPPS and to the panelists and to our moderator for being here tonight. I think as we give thanks, we should also give thanks for the weather that is holding off until tomorrow so we can all be here. The purpose of the program tonight and next Monday is to explore locally what our faith traditions share, but also what make us unique, and to ask if it is possible to consider that we are neighbors, even family, at a time when we are being tempted by other forces in the world to separate. We have five faith traditions represented tonight. Certainly, this does not exhaust the number of faith traditions who claim Abraham as their father, much less other traditions. On the stage tonight are representatives from Islam, Judaism, and three branches of Christianity, Roman Catholic, Protestant, and Evangelical. Of course, for example, the Protestant tradition might be represented by an Episcopal priest, or a Methodist minister, or a Lutheran minister. We simply had to choose one. The same might be said of any of the other traditions on stage as well. There were many choices to be made. Thanks go to our moderator, panelists, and WIPPS. Again, this dialogue assumes that while each of us represents a unique tradition and a set of beliefs that are unique to us, it might even be that there is something within us, though, that yearns to identify with each other through not only our identity with Abraham, but also through God or Allah. It takes courage and humility to enter into this moment with each other and to share this space. We hope that carries over into the questions and discussions we have with you. After sharing time preparing for this night and next Monday with the panelists, I feel comfortable saying we are not afraid to raise questions, even difficult questions. We are not afraid to see beyond or even within our unique faith traditions and ask if there is a single God, the dreams of a family of families with God at the center. We're not afraid to explore how different faith traditions can claim a relationship with a God, presumably the same God for all. We have a unique opportunity to wrestle with such questions and others like it tonight. Will there be answers? I'm not so sure there will be answers. But wrestling with the questions will make us stronger and even wiser in how we see God, how we see each other, and how we see ourselves. With that as an introduction, I'd like to step back and introduce our moderator for tonight and for next Monday. She is well respected and well known in our area, having been an anchor for Channel 9 News for many years. We are honored that she would be willing to join us and lead our discussion tonight, and we thank Melissa Langbehn for being there.
Thank you very much, Reverend Klutterman. Can you all hear me? Can you hear me? I tend to be very soft-spoken, so I want to make sure that everyone can hear me. I think it's wonderful that everyone showed up here today to get this discussion, this conversation going, and we want you to be very involved in this process. I urge you, if you do have questions, please put your question down on a piece of paper, and one of the interns will get it up here, because this is all about answering your questions, and we hope that you will be involved in this opportunity. It's a great way for us to reflect on the diverse religions, faiths here in North Central Wisconsin, our faiths and how they shape us and also how they shape how we react to the world around us. And we have some fabulous panelists here tonight, five people who are joining us tonight and will share what their faith means to them. I would like to introduce you to each of our experts. I will warn you, they have changed the seating chart on me, so I'm going to have to kind of take a look here. So the first person on the stage to my far right, Deacon Peter Burek, and he is with the Roman Catholic religion, and right now he actually was ordained back in 1999 and has worked with Wausau's Catholic churches, two specifically right now, St. Michael's, and also he is working with the Church of the Resurrection. He's had experience with St. Anne's as well. Now, he is a deacon, so he also has a day job, and he works with the Wausau Metro Bus Service in Wausau. So thank you so much for joining us. Pastor John Payne, second in line here. He is the senior pastor at Good News Church in Mosinee. He has been there since 2008. He spent 20 years working as a youth pastor and has been very involved in the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. He may be one of the few people in this room that is willing to admit that he is a fan of the Dallas Cowboys. Thank you so much for being here. Third, we have Dr. Abul Rabanny. He represents the Islamic Society of Central Wisconsin based in Marshfield. He is a frequent panelist for interfaith dialogues like this one. He is a manager at PepsiCo, which is based up in Rhinelander, and has also held a number of other lab and ag positions in Wisconsin and also in the state of Minnesota as well. So welcome so much. Professor Shanny, he is kind of pinch hitting for Rabbi Dan Danson today, who will be joining us next week. He represents the Jewish faith, and he is a professor of religious studies at UW-Stevens Point. His interests are religion and popular culture. He is Jewish. His wife is Christian. So he says he's been living with discussions of religious differences for 20 years now.
Fantastic.
Thank you so much for being here. And finally, not last, or last but not least, of course. Now I'm out of order here because my seating chart is done. This is Mother Jane Johnson. She is from Stevens Point, the priest of Intercession Episcopal Church. She has been there since the year 2011. Before she was ordained, she had another life. She actually worked as a high school teacher. And she is also very involved in her community, working in Justice Works. That is a program that is designed to help jail inmates avoid going back into jail upon release. So doing some great work out there. And welcome so much for joining us tonight. Great to see you. We do have several questions that we have written out beforehand so that we would be prepared to have get things started. And what we want to do, first of all, is have each one of our panelists answer one question, and that has to do specifically with their faith. And what we are going to do is we are going to set a 3-minute time limit on this question. Most of the other questions are just going to be a conversation, free-flowing. But this one, we want to give you an introduction to their faith. And the question is, first of all, we will go in alphabetical order for this one. Give us an introduction to your faith and describe your relationship to that faith. We will begin with Deacon Burek.
I think most times religion is a offshoot of your upbringing. And I was born into a Catholic family. And at some point, you have to make that belief system your own. So during that course of growing up and growing up in the church and that sort of thing, I have kind of taken the path of becoming a ordained minister. And with that, the responsibility of kind of leading others in the faith. So when we talk about the Catholic way of faith, we talk about a faith that has a great 2,000-year tradition that goes back to the apostolic tradition. And that's one of the things that appeals to it, it appeals to me the most about it. And by the same token, a great history of social justice issues, founding of hospitals and social services organizations, and, you know, helping our neighbor, putting the words of Jesus into good work. So with that tradition, it's really a good basis for putting the words of Jesus and the words that Jesus comes to teach us and animate our lives with into effect. So I'm currently involved in the Eastside Catholic parishes, and that is two individual parishes of St. Michael's and Resurrection that share a common administration, which is getting more and more common for faith communities to be combined as time goes on. So in that great tradition of 2,000 years, there have been lots of good things about the Catholic faith, and there have been things that sometimes we're not so proud of. But throughout that whole tradition, we have faithfully tried to hold to the teachings of Jesus in even modern times, with the challenges of modern times as well.
Thank you very much. Pastor Payne?
All right. I was introduced to Christianity by my parents as well. As a child, I remember them telling me that Jesus Christ loved me and demonstrated his love for me willingly by dying for my sin. Now, I was aware of it. I was a sinner, but I was only a small child. I hadn't robbed any convenience stores or done anything major, but I was aware that I was a sinner. And because of my sin, I needed to ask God to forgive me of my sin, and I placed my faith in Jesus Christ's sacrificial death and his supernatural resurrection. I don't think I fully understood that, and I would be, if I were honest with you today, I would say, I don't know that I still understand all the ramifications of that today. And that really is kind of the basis of faith, isn't it? Trusting or believing in what you don't necessarily fully comprehend, but you have a faith and a trust in it. Well, as a teenager, I was asked this very challenging question. Are you going to live your life for John Payne or for Jesus Christ? Now, as Melissa said, growing up, I was a fan, and still am a fan of the Dallas Cowboys. Don't throw anything here. But my dream was to be quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. Well, there was a guy from Oklahoma named Troy Aikman who got my job, so to speak. And as a teenager, I was at a camp in Iowa where I grew up. And all week long, we were being challenged with that question. Are you going to surrender your life to what God would want for you? Or are you going to take control and try and have your life be lived according to your dreams and plans and goals? So finally, at the end of that week, I surrendered and said that I wanted to spend my life as an ambassador for Jesus Christ the rest of my life. I was fearful that God would send me to some remote part of the world, but Wisconsin was as remote as he chose so far. And we've lived here for over 23 years, and I'm trying to learn God's continued purpose as he reveals that for my life, and I want to follow Jesus and live my life by his example.
Thank you very much. Dr. Rabanny?
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. This is Islamic greetings to the people. The peace be upon all of you. I born in a Muslim family in 1963, but I was not actually practiced Muslim. But in 1997, when I was in PhD course, I had a problem with my experiment. About 10,000 small grapefruit I actually analyzed for their composition. And I found each and every fruit has different composition. It's not matching each other. Then I talked to my professor, how we can compile this data. It's very difficult. Then we try to do several things. So on the one Friday, we have a Friday congregation prayer. I went and one imam told one verse in the Quran. And they said, God says, I created all the fruits tree, and you add same water, same things, but I put the taste different from each fruit to another fruit. And that clicked my brain. And then I started a little practice as a Muslim. And still I am doing this. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
So you asked to talk a little bit about the introduction to our faith as well as my relationship. So I'm a professor of religious studies. I talk about other people's religion all day long. I'm not at all used to talking about my own religion. But I'll touch on both those. So very briefly, I think the essential way that I would describe Judaism in just a minute or so is that Judaism is about the relationship between the community of Jews and God. That there's a covenantal relationship, a contract between the Jewish people and God. And that contract makes requirements on both sides, that the Jewish people have signed a contract with God in which they are required to behave in certain ways, and that God also is part of this contract and agrees to behave in certain ways. And in the write-up that you all received, the other aspects of that contract involve Jewish scripture, the Torah, which is God's message to Jews traditionally understood, and the state of Israel, which is considered, written about in the Bible and considered by many contemporary Jews to be Jewish sacred land. You also asked us to talk about our own experience, and so I'll tell just a very brief story about my own experience since moving here. I'm originally from Baltimore, which, when I went to school, it didn't have a large Jewish community. It was still a minority, but it was a pretty substantial minority. And so I had Jewish friends in every class and Jewish teachers, and I went to Hebrew school, and so there was a pretty substantial Jewish community. When I came here, I met Rabbi Dan Danson at an event, and he asked me if I was interested in coming to talk to some Jewish middle school and high school kids. And I'd gone to those things when I was in middle school and high school, and so I agreed to do it, and I thought my approach would be talking about how lame these kinds of things are when parents make you come to these things and how uncool they are. And so, because that was my own experience with them. And so I told Dan I would do it, and I met with these kids, and so I started off with that approach. And when I met the Jewish kids from Wisconsin, this is 2009, the first year I moved here, what impressed me about them was their experience was completely different than mine. They were not at all, they didn't perceive this as kind of a lame or uncool thing to do, and they talked about how excited they were to be around other Jewish people and how rare of an experience that was for them. I was incredibly affected by that experience, and it made me think about my Judaism differently. And since then, Rabbi Danson has persuaded me to teach Sunday school, and I've done that ever since, and it's primarily because of those kids that I met and their response and how touched I was by how much they wanted to be around a Jewish community and how much it meant to them. Thank you.
Thank you. Mother Jane? So, as a good Episcopalian, I'm going to start by interpreting the question differently than anybody else did. Because the Episcopal Church is first and foremost a church of spectrums. As a church, as a whole church, we are fairly progressive, but parishes or congregations within the church vary widely on kind of the progressive to conservative spectrum. In many ways, as Episcopalians, we are a people who have agreed to live within the tension of agreeing not to agree on everything. And therefore, this means that we can hold different interpretations of scripture and teaching within the church. The Episcopal Church is a denomination of the Christian faith that was founded from the belief of Queen Elizabeth I that there needs to be a middle way, middle between Catholicism, which we now call Roman Catholicism since its center is in Rome, and Protestantism. We're an Anglican Catholic Church since our center is in Canterbury, England, stemming from the Church of England. We're liturgical and sacramental, so what does that mean? Liturgical means that when we meet on Sunday mornings, we have a pattern of worship that we repeat every Sunday and prayers that have been with us since the beginning of our church's beginning.
We're sacramental in that we think the Holy Spirit works through common stuff like bread and wine and water and oil in order to restore us into God's image of us. And our whole life together centers around Holy Communion. Some people call it Holy Eucharist. Some people call it the Mass. Some people call it the Lord's Supper. But we do that at least weekly. We have two sacraments that are crucial to our life, baptism and communion. And we have five other sacramental rites, like confession, confirmation, marriage, ordination, and unction, or using oil for healing and restoration and prayer. And we believe that all things necessary for us for salvation can be found in Holy Scriptures. And we interpret and come to understand what we think about our text in community. And we use Scripture, tradition, and reason. And reason includes lived experience in order to understand Scripture, in order to understand the teaching of the church, in order to understand God, in order to understand one another. So that's why we end up with a whole lot of gray areas and not a whole lot of black and white areas. We're a member of something called the Anglican Communion, and the head of the Anglican Communion is the Archbishop of Canterbury. I am a born Episcopalian, although for a couple of years I was Syrian Orthodox. My father was a priest, and now I'm a priest.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Does everyone have a better understanding of who our panelists are? Excellent. We will move on to our second question. Again, if you have a question, please let one of the runners know. They'll bring it up here and we'll get to it as quickly as possible. Our second question is, what is something that you want others who are not familiar with your faith community to know about it? What is something that you want others who are not familiar with your faith community to know about it? Pastor Payne?
Sure. Well, Christianity would attest that the clearest way that God revealed himself to us as humans was not through nature or the Bible, even though both reveal the existence of God. The single greatest revelation of who God is, according to Christianity, would be his son, Jesus Christ. I heard Paul Harvey tell this story to help explain what that looks like or what it means. He told the story of a farmer from living in cold, snowy Midwest. And we know a little bit what that's like, and we'll know a little bit more about that tomorrow. And he was a farmer, and one night after doing his chores, he had sat down next to a warm, cozy fire by the fireplace, and he's sitting there, and he looks outside his window, and he sees a bunch of birds that are sitting there shivering and freezing. He has a thought, you know, my barn is plenty large enough and very warm. If those birds would just go into that barn, they could find safety and warmth. So he puts on his overcoat, puts his boots back on, goes out, opens the door of the barn, hoping that the birds would come and find warmth and shelter. They didn't. They're birds. So he grabbed some bird seed and thought he would put a path leading to the barn, and the birds ate a couple of the pieces of the bird seed and then huddled back up again. So he tried by thinking, maybe I can shoo them over and get them to go into the barn. Well, they just flew away and then reassembled. Frustrated and cold, he heard church bells in the distance and had this revelation. Me trying to tell these birds how to get in there, the only way I could do that successfully would be if I were to become a bird and try and communicate with them in their language and show them the safety of the barn. And he said that's exactly what Jesus Christ did. He became a human being, came to earth, took on the nature of a human being, remaining fully God, and came so that he could communicate to us who Jesus, who he was, and who the Father is.
Who would like to jump in next?
Okay, so I think most of you knows Islam. Islam actually is a Abrahamic faith. We believe oneness of God, no partners with the God. And we believe all the prophets, starting from the Adam to Muhammad, including Moses, David, John Baptist, Jesus, everyone. And among all the prophets, we believe five prophets is chosen prophet, messenger to the God. And the five is Abraham himself, Moses, then Jesus, Abraham, Moses, David, Jesus, and Prophet Muhammad as the last messenger. But other things like some principle of Islam we have, like many people think that in Islam, men and women is not equally right, but we have equal right is the Quran chapter 3 and verse 195, it says we have men and women is equal. Islam shares many religious figures and historical events with Judaism and Christianity. And as I told before, that we greatly respect Moses and Jesus, both our two messengers, peace be upon them. Muslim fast 30 days consequently in a year. And we have a spiritual impact for this fasting. The spiritual is that we can earn God's pleasure because he commanded us to do that. And the socioeconomic impact is we can learn for the poor people who are hungry, hunger, how their feelings. So then we can deliver some our resources to them for livelihood. And this philosophy led us to pay zakat. We call zakat in Arabic term, but in English it's a compulsory, obligatory charity. Is whatever we have a savings, 2.5% of the savings, we have to pay for this donation. Is a mandatory. If we don't pay that one, all of our spiritual activities nullified. We should, that's mandatory. We have to do that. Then there are another things. The Islam does not allow any kind of violence or any kind of oppression by each other. Islam promotes to put the justice in the earth, among the people, among the nature, everything. That's all. Thank you.
Does anyone else want to?
I guess the thing that I would want people to know most about the Episcopal Church is for a long time, and maybe you don't know this phrase, but we were kind of known as the frozen chosen. The Episcopal Church kind of got this moniker because often our worship has been seen as very formal. And there were some very well-to-do people in the beginning of the church. Not so much the case anymore always, but so we kind of had this stiff upper lip and stuffed shirt kind of mode about us. But the Episcopal Church, our presiding bishop says that we're the Episcopal branch of the Jesus movement. So in the Episcopal Church, you will find very formal worship, but you will also find people who are really on fire for God and who are very charismatic and evangelical and passionate about it. And so there's this really wide variety. Even though we have this common bond of this pattern of worship, because we are a church of spectrums, there's going to be a wide variety in the Episcopal Church. There are a lot of fun people in the Episcopal Church. And we really have a heart, especially for working with people of all faiths and doing a lot of ecumenical work. And so I would invite people to just kind of explore different of faiths and congregations, but also different Episcopal churches, because you're going to find a variety in a lot of ways. But what I think you will almost always find is a group of people who desire to be about the flourishing of the common good and the flourishing of all people and the restoration of this world. Our presiding bishop often refers to it in this way, that we are a people who are calling people to God's dream, living into God's dream for creation, instead of the nightmare we often find ourselves living.
people think of Roman Catholicism, a lot of times they think of obeying rules and that sort of thing. But I think it's important to remember that the whole story of God is a love story. People are at their best when they're in a loving relationship. And God seeks us out with that loving relationship, first in the call to Abraham and that long faith tradition, and then in God becoming incarnate, in God, you know, God's Son, Jesus, coming. And in the story of, we're just past Christmas now, so the story of the three wise men who come from Persia to visit the baby Jesus, and the face of American Catholicism in the 50s and the 60s, Archbishop Fulton Sheen, tells the story of as the wise men came to Jesus, because of circumstances in the scripture, they returned to their home via a different route. And Bishop Sheen said, of course they did. No one ever comes to Jesus and then returns to the way that they came. So it's important to remember that love story.
Your question was about, was it misconceptions? About
What is something that you want others to know that they might not know about you?
One thing I would say about Judaism is that people may not know is the range of what counts as Jewish within the Jewish community can be incredibly broad. There's a traditional definition, understanding of what it is to be Jewish, and it has to do with monotheistic faith, and it has to do with certain rituals and celebrating certain holidays. But there are also Jews who identify as atheists, but still consider themselves Jewish. There are Jews who practice Buddhism, but still identify as Jewish. There's so many, in fact, Jews who practice some aspects of Buddhism that there's even a name for them. They're called Jubus. And so the range of what is possible within Judaism and the way in which Judaism defines itself both religiously but also culturally or as a people, as a community, I think is something that a lot of people may not be aware of.
We do have an audience question now, and this question is, what is your tradition's image of an afterlife, and how does a person attain the afterlife? What is your tradition's image of an afterlife, and how does a person attain the afterlife? Mother Jane, would you like to begin?
Sure. I would just love to begin, Melissa. Thank you very much. And if I don't answer your question exactly as you wanted to, I'm sorry. But so when I think of afterlife, I think that's often a word that's used for the word heaven. And heaven, and okay, let me just qualify this. I am speaking through an Episcopal lens. I am certainly not representing every mainline Protestant tradition out there. And even in the Episcopal Church, remember, a church of spectrums, I'm speaking my slice, right? So my brothers and sisters might not feel exactly the same way I do, and we live in that tension. So heaven, to me, is wherever God dwells. And it isn't something in the future, it is something now. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven has come here. And so when we know that we're in God's presence, and for us that can happen in different ways, I've often felt times when I've felt that I'm in God's presence, that's a taste of heaven. And so heaven is something that we experience now, and because we can taste it now and experience it now, we can begin to believe in it and begin to believe there is another kingdom, if you will. And this idea of, I don't believe that our life is all about getting into heaven. I believe that heaven is already here and now, and what we're doing is living this process of being in relationship with other people, because that's huge. Loving other people is what it means to love God. And so that relationship strengthens our relationship with God, and that God promises to have this relationship with us for eternity. God's deepest desire is for all of us to be restored, I believe, for all of us to be restored to that relationship with God. And I'm just going to give myself away. Here's the thing. I think God's going to get what God wants.
Any other takers?
Dr. Rabanny, I'm going to have you speak up just a little bit. It's just a little difficult. Let me help. I'm going to come over there and help you with that.
It's not working. Good.
We're thinking if we bring this up just a little.
Oh, okay.
And just maybe just set it right there. And yeah.
Okay. That'll Thank be
good
you.
Like that. Yeah.
In Islam, God, in our language, in Arabic language, we actually call Allah instead of God. Mm-hmm. So for next conversation, actually, I want to say Allah. So just you match with the God. So Allah says in the Quran, and he gives us all the picture. After our death, the eternal life, how it would be. So I personally, we cannot imagine or image what's our after death, but what's our thing, something after life. So God says, if we do something here, good deeds, and follow the what Allah mentioned us, something good deeds and prayer, fasting, those things, he will reward us with heaven. And he explained in the Quran how heaven looks like. He says it's a garden. And there are a lot of rivers under the garden. That he only explained. But I don't know, most of the people does not know what kind of garden. Is a garden like earth? We don't know. So heaven looks like that. And he said, in the garden, when the heavenly people don't need to effort to earn some sustaining, like food, drinks, like this. Whenever they wish, it comes to them. That's the explanation feature he mentioned in the Quran about the heaven. On the other side, if I do hear bad things, if I disobey God's command, if I do something sin, and Allah will not forgive me, then he will put me into the hell. And he also explained how it looks like. It's a burning fire. There are 7 steps in the hell, the fire. The bottom one is the most hottest. And based on our sin, we will go in the bottom or middle or the top like this. So he mentioned these 2 things in the Quran based on our action in the earth. So we will not imagine actually how it's look like, but he already explained how it's look like. That's what we believe.
In Judaism, is this on? Can you hear me? In Judaism, the question of the afterlife is a really complicated one, in part because Jewish texts and Jewish scribes and rabbis were not especially that interested in nailing down specifically what the afterlife was like. And so in Jewish scripture and in Jewish rabbinic writing, there are all kinds of different metaphors for what the afterlife might look like, or nothing at all. There's one that I share with my students that rabbis describe the afterlife as being kind of like a library where you go and you just study and read books all day and all night long. And that is what heaven is. And my students are shocked by that. That doesn't seem at all like the heaven that they would have any interest in being in. But for scholars, for rabbis, I guess that does sound like heaven. And so in Judaism, there is not a particular singular notion of the afterlife because I think the afterlife is not the reward that God gives you for being Jewish. In Judaism, the reward you get for being Jewish is you get to follow God's commandments. You get to have this relationship with God. And then in Jewish scripture, you get the land of Canaan, the land of Israel. That is primarily what the reward that one receives for practicing Judaism and for being Jewish. And so rabbis have all kinds of different kind of creative
ways to think about it, but whichever one a person chooses to believe could be as right or accurate as any other.
The question is about the afterlife. What is your faith's image of an afterlife, and how does a person attain the afterlife?
Okay. Jesus said that when he came to give life and life to the fullest, not just merely existence, but an abundant life. And I meet people all the time who say, you know, John, my life doesn't seem to have meaning. I've tried, fill in the blank, and I'm having a hard time finding what my purpose, what my meaning for being on this planet is. You know, it reminds me of H.G. Wells, the famous historian philosopher at age 61, who said, I have no peace. All life is at the end of a tether. People who are looking for purpose and meaning in life. Ralph Barton, one of the top cartoonists of a former era, left this note pinned to his pillow before taking his own life at 39 years of age. He said, quote, I've had few difficulties, many friends, great successes. I've gone from one wife to another one, from owning house to house, visited great countries of the world, but I'm fed up with inventing devices to fill up 24 hours of my day. How tragic to think that you spend your whole life trying to find a purpose, trying to find a meaning, when Jesus says, I've come that you might have purpose and you might have life and you might have it abundantly. But Jesus didn't just offer us meaning for life while here on earth. I believe he also offers us eternal life through the sacrificial death and a miraculous, as I said, supernatural resurrection of his son Jesus Christ that gives us hope of an existence. The 60, the 70, the 80 years that you might be graced to live on this earth are just a vapor in comparison to eternity. And scripture shows us that the eternal life in heaven comes through faith in Jesus Christ, and that it's not something we can earn, but it's something that he's done for us, and that by placing our faith in him, heaven is a place where there's no more death, mourning, crying, or pain. And I'm so glad it's spelled P-A-I-N, not P-A-Y-N-E, like my last name.
The only thing that I would add to that is the whole idea of heaven or afterlife comes to us a lot of times through artistic endeavor. And a lot of our ideas are, you know, gleaned from that idea. However, there are many places in the New Testament scriptures that Jesus talks about it. One of my favorites is that story of the religious leaders that came to him that didn't believe in an afterlife and kind of had a trick question of the woman who was married to the seven brothers, and they all died. And then the question was, whose wife will she be in the afterlife? And Jesus kind of gives a warning about that. He gives a warning about assuming that heaven or the afterlife or whatever label you want to put on it, assuming that that is like now. It's not like now. He doesn't give us a description, but he gives us a warning to be careful of making assumptions about what it's like, because it's not like this.
Okay.
Would you mind if I ask a follow-up question about the afterlife thing? I'm interested in hearing from any of you what your feelings are or what your faith tradition believes about the afterlife in the context of people outside of your religion. What do you think about people who are non-members of your faith and what happens to them in the afterlife? Any takers?
Well, go ahead.
In Quran, we have one verse. It's about, I forgot the verse name. So, number. That verse says that no matter you are Muslim or other than Muslim, whoever has a good deeds, the good deeds is a two things, two aspects, good deeds. One is in Arabic called akidah, and another is called akhlaq. Akidah means is a identify your God and your relation to the God. This is called Akidah. So how you identify my God and how establish my relationship with my God. So based on this one is one kind of good deeds. And that good deeds is Allah will reward for you, that one. And another good deeds is a very interesting term we call Sharia. It's a law, principle in the world. How you spend your life, like charity is one of the part of Sharia, like helping poor people, helping patients or neighbor, those things, those the established of justice, in those are actually akhlaq, our character, how we expose ourselves that I am a human being. So the good deeds for those things is rewarded by the God, by himself, no matter you are Muslim or out of the Muslim. All are equally rewarded for those Sharia or worldly good deeds. But the Akidah, God has own perception, that one. He may be forgive non-Muslim, but he will not forgive Muslim because we did maybe something offense. Being a Muslim does not mean we are guaranteed to go hell, yeah, heaven. Because we have to establish all of the commands, both Akidah and Akhlaq. Then we can imagine, maybe we will be forgiven. Unless God's forgiveness, we will not go to heaven. That's our bottom line. So we need his forgiveness. That's our philosophy.
From the Catholic perspective, there's a very beautiful saying, ancient saying, that so as the church prays, so the church believes. And on Good Friday, the Good Friday service, there's a very beautiful series of prayers that address this issue that you've talked about. And that is, we pray for not only Christian believers, but for our brothers and sisters in the Jewish faith, other faiths, people who have no faith, people who are guided by the goodwill of God, and we pray for all that. So I would have to conclude that we're kind of rooting for everybody and hoping everybody gets in, whether they're, you know, obeying the rules or not.
Yes. And let me just qualify this with two things. I could be wrong. And the other tagline that I live with is, God's a mystery, get over it. So not really knowing, right, the answer to this, but believing that all are made in the image of God, all of creation is God's, and that God deeply desires all of creation to be restored. And as I said, I believe that, you know, God's love wins. And so to me, we have free will, and so that means eventually we can choose to grow in this relationship with God and re-choose, because if you're anything like me, you have to do it over and over and over again, or not. But I think the other piece is that human beings want to think that God lives in time like we do, and so where is that judgment day? Where is that end time? I don't know. I don't think it's happening while I'm alive, thank you. And I'm not even certain that it happens at the moment of my death. But I think that in the Catholic faith, as the deacon has said, we really believe that God deeply desires all of God's creation to be restored. And so that door is open.
To answer Shani's question about what would Christianity teach for those who reject Jesus Christ and what would be their fate, I believe was the question. Jesus said that he was the way, the truth, and the life, and no one could come to his Father unless they come through him. And I would say that if I were God, and thank heaven I'm not, right? But if I gave my one and only son to pay for the sins of humanity, and said that he was the only way through which people could come to relationship with me, and people were to reject my one and only son who I love. And I know some of the panelists here would have a different view of who Jesus is, but if God said his son into this world to die for the sins of humanity and then to miraculously be raised again the third day, conquering both sin and death, and Jesus said that the only way to get to the Father was through him, then if someone rejects Jesus Christ as the way, the truth, and the life, and the way to the Father, it's not John up here saying that that person will be placed in eternal, you know, separation from God. It's Jesus saying that that would be what would happen to someone who rejects his work of salvation and his resurrection.
Okay, thank you. This question leads into one that is specifically for Professor Luft. How is the Messiah understood in Judaism? And second, how is Jesus understood? For all of you, the rest of you, who is Jesus in your faith?
The Messiah question is a really interesting one. Because, of course, when I teach a New Testament class, and so I talk to students about Judaism in the first century and how the idea of the Messiah is a traditionally Jewish idea, although the notion of the Messiah is not one that contemporary Jews speak about particularly. I think in Dan's notes in the packet that some of you received, it may say that you could go to a synagogue every week for a year and never hear the Messiah get mentioned at all. And so the concept of the Messiah, while beginning in Judaism, is not one that contemporary Judaism focuses on especially. And that, I think, in part relates to what I said earlier, which is that Judaism as a religion is not especially focused on the afterlife or the return of the Messiah or something like that. The other thing you asked was about Jesus. And so in traditional Judaism, of course, the Hebrew scriptures are written before the life of Jesus, and traditionally Jews don't believe that the text of the Hebrew Bible foresees or references or foretells anything about the life of Jesus. And therefore, Jesus is sort of a non-issue in Judaism. It's not a being that is significant. I sometimes say to my students that Jews think about Jesus the same way that Christians think about the Buddha, which is, you may find the Buddha interesting or not interesting or inspiring or not inspiring, but the Buddha is not significant to the belief of Christianity, and one might never hear the Buddha ever spoken by a Christian, and that would be perfectly acceptable and not surprising. And that's the case with Judaism and Jesus as well.
Thank you. Our other panelists, who is Jesus in your tradition?
As I told before, that Jesus is one of the most important messenger in our tradition. And Allah explained who is Jesus in the Quran. We have a full chapter we call Surah Maryam, is the name after mother of Jesus, Maryam. And he mentioned who is Jesus, how he came. And in this chapter, he mentioned Jesus was born like a Adam. Allah says in the Quran. So miracle is, Allah gave him specific miracles, and he used that miracles by the name of Allah. And those are described by Allah himself in that chapter. So we see Jesus as a most important messenger, peace be upon him. And also we see, and also in the Quran, Allah said, Jesus will be Messiah in the end of the time. He will come back. So that's, we identify Jesus in our tradition.
Jesus is the Son of God. We believe in one God with three persons. Again, God's a mystery, get over it. And I try to think of metaphors for people because that's how my brain works. Maybe that's why I like the Gospel of John so much. And the best that I have for you tonight is think of a Brazil nut. because it has three sides, right? Or at least in my brain on the way here, it did have three sides. And so, you know, God is one thing. And one side is this God that's the creator. And one side is this God that's the redeemer that restores the brokenness. And one side is this sanctifier, this side of God that empowers us and strengthens us and ties it all together. Because if we're created and we're broken and we need to be sanctified so that we can be made whole and restored. And so that's God moving in the world. And Jesus would be the redeemer part of that. Jesus is God made flesh, God with us. In very simple terms, Jesus is God made human so that we might know what it is to be human, so that we might know the way to be human, the life to be human, and the truth of being human.
Jesus made some very specific claims about his identity when he was here on earth. And C.S. Lewis, who, for our younger audience members, was a contemporary of Tolkien, who wrote Lord of the Rings, C.S. Lewis was a great theologian. He wrote a book called Mere Christianity. He said the very claims that Jesus made when he was here on earth, to make those claims, there had to be three conclusions that we'd come up with as to who he is. Either he's a lunatic, because the claims that he made as to who he was and why he was sent either was lunacy, or he was the world's greatest liar, or he was the Lord who he said he was. And we have to grapple with the evidence and come to that understanding and that decision on our own. Each individual will be held accountable for how their decision in coming to if they determine if he's a liar or a lunatic or the Lord. And I would say, you know, studying the Old Testament, there are many, many prophecies, over 700 and some prophecies that I believe Jesus specifically fulfilled. A mathematician took those prophecies and did a chance as to what that would be like for one person to fulfill all 700 and some of those prophecies. They said it'd be like taking the state of Texas, again, a cowboy reference, I apologize, and filling it with quarters 3 feet deep, being blindfolded and spun around, walking into that, and there was one quarter that had a hole punched in the middle of it, and the one and the only quarter that you would pick up would be that one quarter with the punch in the hole in it. And that's the odds of which one person would fulfill 730-some prophecies, and that's why Christians believe that Jesus Christ is who he said he was, would be Lord.
One of the central tenets of the faith in the Roman Church is that Jesus is true God, true man, both. And that is a mystery that has vexed us for 2,000 years, of course, because there's a lot of times we want to discount his humanness and say, well, he's God, so he had a little easier time. Or we want to discount his deity, his godness. So that tension between true God, true man, has powered many a afterthought in the 2,000-year history of Christianity. But it's also central to our belief that Son of God, taking on our flesh, and becoming one of us. So, true God, true man, central to our faith.
Okay. Thank you all. Our next question is from the audience, and this is specifically, it's a two-part question. First of all, the first question is for Dr. Rabanny, and then there is another question for the rest of the panelists. Dr. Rabanny, what is the origin of radical Muslim, and what is its relationship to the rest of Islam?
Nice question.
Maybe we should start the timer here.
You know, let's explain in chemistry. The oxygen we breathe is a 2O. There is a 2O, right? And is a good. So when we add another oxygen molecule to that, then it's become O3. Does it good for human being? No. Why? It is ozone. And this additional oxygen is called radical oxygen. So Muslim is who submit to the will of God, will of Allah. And he mentioned what's his will. So whenever someone add foreign particle to the Islam, as for example is a political ideology or power politics, those things, any kind of foreign addition become radicalism. So those are not the part of Islam. Those are actually using the Islam as a tool for their purpose, not the God's, Allah's purpose. And if you look at statistically all over the globe, very few people become a radicalism. And this radicalism is actually is from the very beginning of the Islam. And it's not only Islam. You can go any other religion, everywhere. When its foreign things, ideology comes into the religion, then religion become corrupted. So in Islam, I personally, what we are trying to separate our politics or our foreign materials from the religion. So that's like a radical oxygen is a radical Islam. So it's not a real Islam.
For the rest of the panelists, how does your faith respond to radical Islam or any other radicalized religion?
Jesus told a story when he was here on earth, just speaking from Christianity's response, about, first of all, he said, there's two great commandments. One is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and then to love your neighbor as yourself. So the question of the audience was, who in the world's my neighbor, right? Let's jump to that. Who then is my neighbor? So Jesus begins to tell a story about a man who's beaten up and left on the side of the road. And there's one who comes, puts him on his donkey's back, takes him to a hotel, pays to have him fixed, and says, gives him his platinum American Express card, says, any charges that come due for this man, put them on my account. And Jesus said, that's what we're supposed to do as it relates to our neighbor. Jesus' message was one of, yes, of righteousness and judgment to come, but his message first and foremost was of redemption and love for other people. And so even radicalized other religions, Jesus said they're our neighbors, and our response to them is to love them just as he would.
Aspect of that is also a sense of forgiveness, which is a really hard thing for humanity to live out, but it's at the core of our tradition, of reconciliation. And so love is not just some kind of warm, gushy feeling, right? It's concrete action. And I don't know that we would have a response to a radical Islam or radical Christianity or radical Judaism or, I don't know, radical atheism or radical anything. The response needs to be to human beings. And in that response of love, in that concrete action of love, that is working for the common good so that all people have enough. You know, since we're all made in the image of God, we are all equally deserving of having enough, no matter what our situation is, whether we can work or not work, whether we don't seem to deserve it or we seem to deserve more. Everybody is equally deserving of having enough. That's what God's justice is all about. And so for those people amongst us who might seem to be working against us, part of our tradition and response is to hold them and the situations that are being caused in prayer, and to ask for grace to enter the situation and to work for forgiveness and reconciliation. I don't believe that we are allowed to dismiss anyone. I just really don't think that that's God's plan, that one section of humanity can dismiss another section of humanity for any reason, even when that reason might be violence and vengeance. We are called to something else. And I think the two words that would be part of the Christian tradition are reconciliation and love.
Just one thing. Okay. Just I forgot to mention that one. You know, the Islam actually is a consistent religion. Some Muslim may be radicalized. So there are radical Muslim, but not radical Islam. So we have to differentiate these two. Muslim could be good and bad, but Islam is always good because it's a way of life commanded by Allah for the people. So there is no radical Islam, but there you can say we should say radical Muslim. We can say. Then we can differentiate between the among the Muslims who are radical and who are not radical. Thank you.
I'll move on to the next one here. This is also an audience question. By the way, thank you. We've got some great questions, and we're going to try to move through some of these here. How does your tradition understand creation in light of modern science? I didn't say it was going to be easy. I just
Okay, so let me.
You want to go?
No, you okay. Want to go.
Yeah.
The creation is a. In the Quran, Allah explained how is created everything, the creation. And I believe, so far my knowledge on Torah and Injil, mean Bible, New Testament, the same thing is that Allah mentioned how created the whole universe and the human being. But the science and the religion, these two different. Science, let's see, the Big Bang Theory sometimes says the creation from nothing. But later on, science say, no, nothing cannot be created from nothing. There's something there. So in Islam, Allah explicitly explained how he created 6 days in the universe, and what day he did, when he created heaven, when he created hell, and when he created the human beings and other creations. So compared to the science, and we actually does not comply what science says. We don't comply the what science says about the creation. The creation from nothing, no. Creation from something, and that's the God knows from where he created. There's the creator.
Well, in the Roman Catholic tradition, we're not attached to the Genesis as a how-to book. The important part is that God created the universe and how he specifically did it. We don't view the Bible as a scientific book, so we don't worry about whether it was 7 24-hour periods or, you know, those sorts of things. The important thing is there's stuff that we don't understand about God. You know, God has given us his revelation, but God has not revealed everything that God is God. So while the church in its 2,000-year history has had some bouts with science, you know, it's also a great supporter of science. So we're really, it's not an issue to us, the idea of how. We leave that to science. But the idea of faith, the idea that God, creator of the universe, you know, that's big.
Yes.
In Judaism, there's an enormous range. So there are Jews who believe that the 6 days of creation describe a literal event that's measured in 24-hour periods, that the animals are created in that order. But many Jews, maybe most Jews, read that in various interpretive ways, as poetic, as metaphor, even as a foreshadowing of evolution. And so there's a wide range of possible Jewish interpretations of what the story of creation in Genesis is and how one is supposed to understand the experience of that story. As you said, I think for a lot of Jews, the significance of the story is that God is at the center of it. And so God being the creator and the being that is sort of putting all of these pieces in place, I think is sort of the message of the story and what a lot of Jews would take out of that.
I think that going back to the Brazil nut, that God's main characteristic, right, is that God is creator. God is all about life-giving. And so all of those facets of God and the characteristics of God and God's movement in the world all has to go to being life-giving, this life force. And, you know, for those of us that Genesis is you know, an important book in our story, there are two creation stories. So that offers the spectrum of how we begin to understand it. But again, going back to this idea that God is the creator, and God is all about giving life, restoring life, and new life from where there once was nothing or where there once was death.
The only thing I would chime in and say is that I don't think that the creation account and science have to be at odds. I would say that science, we're continuing to learn. Wouldn't you agree? We're continuing to learn. And part of it is taking it by faith. And one of the things that I used to say is, you like going to the movies and you put on a 3D set of glasses, and you're not able to see certain things in a movie unless you have those 3D glasses on. I say sometimes that some things that we don't understand in science that God does know need 3D glasses, until my friend told me, really, there's 11 or 12 dimensions of color, so I have to say it's a 13-dimensional truth. And so there's certain things that we have to take by faith that we don't understand, but science and God and creation are not in conflict.
Okay. Our next audience question is, what is your favorite part of your faith's worship service?
What's the question?
Pardon? You want me to
repeat the question? Yeah.
What is your favorite part of your faith's worship service? What is your favorite part of your faith's worship service?
For me, I would say I love to hear stories of transformation. And we try and provide opportunities for people to be able to tell their stories of transformation. Because it's amazing how God can bring life to a person and transformation. I visited a gentleman in the jail this last Friday, and he said, I'm trying to be the Apostle Paul at Marathon County Jail. He told me about three young men who came to Marathon County Jail as repeat offenders in their areas of being professional criminals. And he said that he has seen God working through them to a place of transformation. Now, that'll be seen when they're released. But nonetheless, there seems to be transformation. And I love when we have opportunity for people to be able to tell their stories of transformation.
For me, it's probably Holy Communion. And I say this both as, you know, for a long time, I was on the other side of the communion rail. And often, that was always a moment for me when I recognized that I was joined to all these other people, some of whom I loved deeply, some of whom had helped me deeply, some of whom irritated me deeply. But in this moment, was this recognition that we are bound together. Now that I'm on the other side of the communion rail, I always look at people when I hand the bread and I make eye contact, because I believe that we see Christ in the sacraments, and that Christ is known in the sacraments, and then I see Christ in the people who are I am serving the bread to. And you know, we believe that God takes these really common things of bread and wine and makes them holy. And hey, we're made in the divine image, so God can take these common things and make them holy. And for me, on a Sunday morning, I'm reminded of that over and over again, and it's a good thing.
For me, is a everyday 5 times prayer in the house of God. I feel that I'm in front of the God, and I can talk to my God what I need to solve, and God is responding to this. And there is a first chapter in our Quran, Surah Fatiha, every time we recite. And this Fatiha has two parts. First part, I praise the God, and God replied that one. And the second part, I ask him what my problem, so solve me. So this chapter, every 5 times in a day, when we stand in front of the God for our prayer, we call salah or namaz, so I feel good at the time.
Anyone else want to jump?
I would have to just continue with what you said about communion, the Eucharist, and just the whole idea that as important as the scriptures are, and they are very important in our faith tradition, you can search the four gospels and never find a place where Jesus says, hey guys, this is really important, maybe you should write this down. You know, that comes later. But do this in memory of me. This is my body, this is my blood. Do this in memory of me. The church has faithfully done that for 2,000 years and continues to do it. And it somehow enriches us and makes us the body of Christ.
With that being said, I will ask the next question, which is, and this is for each of you, who wrote your sacred scripture, and what is the role of humans in the scriptures? It's an easy one.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Hundreds of people wrote our sacred scriptures, written over thousands of years. It's a multi-vocal, multi-genre collection of writings that human beings redacted and edited. And in the Episcopal tradition, we would say it is inspired by God. It's inspired in in the very first writings. Hopefully it's inspired in the redacting. It's inspired in the interpretation. It's inspired in the hearing of it, right? So, you know, remember the Episcopal Church, spectrum. So we believe that there is no necessarily one right interpretation. Because it has all of these voices. I mean, even the Gospels, which three of them are this narrative story of Jesus' life, and then there's John. And even though they're all telling the same story, they give us all these different images and pictures and understandings and points of view, and that's a richness. And instead of worrying about, you know, oh, we got to have this one line, and we've got to prove that every piece of that one line is right. We embrace all of these nuances and the tension of these different perspectives because there's a richness in that whole ball. So, yes.
In Judaism, the traditional story of course, is Moses going up Mount Sinai and receiving the Ten Commandments. And when Moses receives the Ten Commandments, he also receives the text of the five books of Moses. Additionally, in Judaism, traditionally, Jews have believed that when Moses received the five books of Moses, Moses also received an oral tradition. And the oral tradition is a Jewish interpretation of Scripture. And it includes additional stories. It includes an understanding of how one is to apply certain stories and texts into one's life. And those stories, that oral interpretation, is then collected in the Talmud, which is a collection of rabbinic writings from the between the 3rd and the 6th century.
Actually, Scripture is a Quran. It's a word of God, comes to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as a revelation brought by Angel Gabriel. And then Prophet, when he received the revelation based on situation, there are some revelation, as I told before, Akidah and Akhlaq. Akidah revelation means the introduction of God, how we should relationship those things. Those comes, and Akhlaq, the situation, based on the world situation he faces, then revelation come to him. And those revelation, he orally explained to his followers. And he commanded to the followers, what I am saying as a revelation, Scripture, write down. So they write down in very, very, every like stone like this, they write down. So after death of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the followers actually compile the Scripture. This is actually our sacred text. This is the number one guidance text, the Quran. It has 30 chapters. Each chapter has a different purpose. There is another, we should not say that is sacred. That is the, we call in Arabic, sunnah. It means the how the prophets, Muhammad, peace be upon him, implement that sacred text on his life, on the worldly life. So we call sunnah, means how he actually guide those follower people, how this sacred text, what Allah command me to implement in your daily life. So the sacred text is word of God, and the sunnah is a lifestyle of Prophet Muhammad. So these two things, actually all the Muslim, whoever say Shia, Sunni, whatever, all Muslim hold these two things as our guidance. One is sacred text, word of God, one is the lifestyle of Prophet Muhammad, how he implement the Quran.
Can I pop something in here? As you're saying that, Rabbani, I'm thinking like, because we have the Holy Bible, right, the Word of God in these scriptures, and then we have Jesus, who we also call the Word, which is how we're supposed to live those scriptures. So it's like, I'm like hearing the same kind of idea in both of these things that I had never like put together before. So thank you for that description.
I think when, among Christianity, we pretty much all agree that it's inspired by God. Where it breaks down is what that means. And usually, the heart of that question is, did God actually move the hand with the writing instrument in it? And that's one way of looking at it. The Catholic way is not that way, that God moved the hand of the writer. However, it's inspired, and we take into account context and the audience it's written for speaks to us as well, the language it's written in, the time, all of those sorts of things we take into account in trying to understand God's revelation. So,
the only thing I would add is that it's amazing the Bible written over a 1,000-year period of time. The way that there's such unity of thought and unity of fact and history. Like Deacon Peter said, Christianity, evangelical Christianity, would not hold to that it was just a dictatorial way of God moving the hand, but people wrote as they were led by the Holy Spirit. And there are different usages, as we see literary styles that God used and employed over a 1,000-year period of time with complete unity. And like you said, the living word, Jesus Christ in John 1, and the written word, the word of God that we have together, like what Dr. Money said.
So what is your response then when a group or a person seems to misuse or hijack your sacred text for their own purpose?
Not new. You know, one of the, when I talked, I'm going to the Dominican Republic in with a couple of evangelical pastors from the Wausau area to train Haitian and Dominican pastors for a week after Easter. And one of the things that we're going to try and help these Haitian and Dominican pastors, we want to learn from them too, but one of the things we want to help them with is how to interpret God's word. And we believe that there's an observation, which is kind of a 30,000 foot view of God's word. You look at the context in which it was written, you look at the audience into it was intended to be written, and then, you know, from that 30,000 foot view, you move down to an interpretation, and you use other parts of Scripture to interpret other parts of Scripture. And then the final piece after observation, interpretation, is application. The so what, right? We have to come to not just reading God's word and saying, okay, that's great information, but now what are we going to do with it? It's kind of like knowing you need to go on a diet when you come back from the doctor and just filing it in your file cabinet and not doing something about it. And so observation, interpretation, and application. And unfortunately, probably with all of us, the sacred texts have been misused and pulled out of context and used inappropriately.
I actually think this question has great relevance for us as communities, because if we who believe in this God of creation, this God of love, this God of reconciliation, if we can't sit down and have a civil discourse where we can agree to disagree, then I'm not quite sure what we're doing. So, you know, I think there's a difference between a reaction and a response. My reaction, which hopefully stays inside me, might be, but hopefully my response is to listen and to have a conversation and to figure out where they're coming from. And in the end, we might be coming from two very different places, but to be able to live in that tension. The Episcopal Church is very much a church of both and you might be right, and you might be right, and yeah, you might be right too, and we might all be right in different ways, right? And that we don't have to, goodness, prove that what my truth is the truth, but that we can live with that disagreement and not feel like we have to react and in some retaliatory way or proving that our understanding. Because frankly, if we're all really honest with ourselves, most of the time something that we hold as maybe a verse of scripture, oh, I totally get it, I totally understand it. You know, 5 years later, life happens, and you now understand that piece of scripture totally differently than you did 5 years ago. And let's give grace to one another that we can recognize that where we are is, our lived experience really is a piece of our interpretation, as well as the history and the context and the language and the people it was written for. And so I think my hope for that question would be that the people of faith could offer a different way of being in this world, and that's a way of civil discourse and a way of trying to listen to one another and being okay if we don't exactly all stand in the same position, especially on a verse of scripture.
I have answered this one in the two ways. So let's see. I don't want to go philosophically answer this one. The easy answer is we just educate our fellow members what the scripture says and how the prophet implement that scripture. That's it. If it is someone hijacking, if it is not mimic with the how prophet used that verses, so it's automatically rejected, because we then find that they are actually hijacking our religion. So that's the way we educate the people. About every Friday we have congregation prayer, and before the congregation prayer we have a 30 minutes sermon, and the sermon service actually is nothing but educate the people based on what the scripture says, how prophet used this scripture and how this scripture can be applicable in the modern context. That's it. That's the way we educate the people.
Scriptures, it depends a little bit about what you think scripture is or what you imagine it to be, right? Is scripture intended to be understood as a text in which there is one correct interpretation, or like a crossword puzzle where you have to fit the right word in every spot, and if you get one wrong word, then the rest of the thing falls apart? And I think there are some individuals and there are some religious traditions in which scripture is, that's how it's understood, that scripture has a kind of specific interpretation and that the religion is like the answer key to the scripture, right? It's like the teacher's edition of the textbook that explains what all the answers to the problems are. What I found really sort of delightful about Jewish scripture is how peculiar so many of the stories in Hebrew scripture are, and how little they offer in terms of self-explanation. Right, so when you read them, they sort of demand that you wrestle with them and make sense of them. They don't, the stories don't meet you halfway. They kind of force you to go 90% of the way and figure out stories of Adam and Eve, or the story of Jacob wrestling with an angel, or the story of Job. These stories don't have any of the kind of modern things that readers expect in terms of explaining psychology or offering a theme or offering the message. And so all of our traditions, I think, are attempts to wrestle with incredibly complex and kind of delightful and fascinating stories that don't offer themselves up to us, that don't just explain themselves.
From there, I'll go to why is the story of Abraham important, and does that still play a role today? Is it still relevant?
The story of Abraham.
I'm not sure.
Would that be? Yeah, there's a lot of Abraham stories.
Is it relevant for us? Are the words still relevant?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In Islam, still is a important Abraham story. We have several stories. For Abraham, first story is how he identified his God. And we actually use that technique how we should identify our God. Second thing, that in every prayer, when we stand in front of our God, there is a one verse we usually recite. That's verse actually recited by Abraham himself when he identified God, that nothing is actually God other than the God what I found, the one God. That's the testimony, actually. Then other story like, you know, the pilgrimage, all the Muslims who have financially solvent and physically solvent, we go to the Mecca for pilgrimage. This is the story of Abraham, that Allah commanded him to call the people to visit the Mecca for pilgrimage once in a life at least. So we implement this one too. Another story, Abraham took his son, we call Ishmael, we believe Ishmael, took his son Ishmael for slaughtering by the command of God. So instead of Ishmael, God testing him. So instead of Ishmael, God, Allah actually slaughtered a lamb. So we implement that story in our, after pilgrimage, we call Eid. So on that day, we call, in Arabic, call Qurbani, sacrifice. We sacrifice for the sake of God by following Abraham's Sunnah, is a tradition. So those Abrahamic story we implement in our tradition.
I suppose that the textbook answer kind of would be progress in human history. You know, mankind progresses to the point where God, the true God, the monotheistic God, can reach out and build relationship with chosen people. And that's, you know, progress in human history and progress in God history, I guess, you know, where we have the beginnings of God revealing what it means to be a human being. So, yeah, I think it's relevant. You know, we continue to progress, hopefully, although sometimes we look at the news and we despair, you know. But all in all, the light is winning.
I think we learn a lot of things from Abraham's saga, and we don't only learn them from Abraham's saga, but that was kind of the beginning, right? And so we learn that God is a God who from barrenness brings new life, that God keeps God's promises. And two of those very important promises, as I've come to understand it with Abraham, you know, being promised children and being promised land. Well, that's security and future. And those are promises that God gives us, security and future. And the other big part is that God will be with us. God does not promise us that there won't be pain, that there won't be suffering, that there won't be death. But God promises that as we walk with him, God is not only capable of providing us with future and security, but deeply desires to do that, and that God keeps his promises, and God can bring new life out of barrenness. And Abraham does this fascinating thing on his journey. Many times, and maybe it's every time, but I don't want anybody to fact check me right now. When God reveals God's self to Abraham, what does he do? He builds an altar. And so he builds this, a sign of God happened here. And that's part of our call as well. How do we build those altars in the world? How do we build these places where God and humanity meet? Whether that's through an action, whether that's through a church, whether that's through a charity outreach. Where do we build these altars in the world where we can, and everybody can look to and see God and humanity met here?
How do you view the roles of women in your faith community?
Very good questions out here, everybody is.
Go ahead, brothers.
Ladies first.
Well, let me just start with God was born into the world through a woman. In the Episcopal Church, there is no exclusion for any sacrament or any position in the church due to gender or sexual identification. So I think that might say it all. You know, if Christ died on the cross for all of humanity, that means all of humanity is found in that beautiful mosaic that we call the body of Christ, we call the church, that we then helpfully call the kingdom of God in creation. And so women play the same part as any other gender or and can enact any role within the church as well in the Episcopal tradition.
In Judaism, it's really different depending on the branch of Judaism. So in Orthodox Judaism, which is the most traditional, men and women are seen as having equally important roles, but also very different roles. So in Orthodox Judaism, women can't traditionally be rabbis, and there's a whole host of other exceptions or ways in which women's roles and men's roles are really separated. And then on the other end of that, Reform Judaism, which is the most liberal branch of Judaism, women are counted equally as men in every aspect of religious life. And Reform Judaism, which develops in Germany and then in America in the early 20th century, women become rabbis, women get bar mitzvahed, women become every part of the religious tradition without any distinctions.
In Islam, in the Quran, there is a full chapter about the role of women. It's a chapter number 4, where Allah describe what's the role of women in the society and what's the position of women in the society as well as in front of Allah's reward. So the role of women in Islam very straightforward in this chapter. Like many, there is a misconception that women cannot be imam. But women can be imam within the women. congregation. But women cannot be imam for Muslim for main congregation. That's the reality. So women can, like instead of me here, women can be placed here, no problem. But the women has a role as a man in the society to deliver the message of Allah, no problem. But in the house or the, like in the worldly things, women and men as a differentiated with the dignity, what women can do and what men cannot do, what men can do, what women cannot do. That's the way equity, not equality, but equity basis, that distributed the role of women.
I love in scripture the way God used men and women throughout history. I look at a woman by the name of Esther, who we're going to be studying this next Sunday at our church, and how she was used to deliver her entire, all the Jewish people of that time from the realm that they were involved under the suppression of. And I look at various judges throughout the Old Testament, women who were used by God greatly. And so I believe that God has created man and woman equal, and in Christ there's equality. And it's exciting to read through Scripture and see how God has used both.
Well, from the sublime to... In the Roman Catholic Church, women are excluded from ordained ministry, those roles of deacon, priest, and bishop, but they're certainly not excluded from ministry. In fact, if women were not ministering the church, it would probably collapse. And I kind of also greet this issue with a bit of a joke, and that is perhaps they knew that the only way to get men to participate was to put them in charge. So, but yes, we are a patriarchal, hierarchical institution.
We are running short on time. My goodness, we have but just a few moments left here. I do want to get to one final question as we wrap things up. I had all these questions I wanted to ask. Next week, I guess. Our final question for each of you is, what is the one thing that you have learned tonight, and the one thing that you hope others have learned about your faith community? And you each have 1 to 2 minutes on this.
One thing that I've learned about the panel is how much we truly do have in common. People of goodwill, people seeking the will of God. And, you know, you can go a long way with that realization. There's sometimes things doctrinally and liturgically and scripturally that get in the way of that process at times. But when you sit down in a room and start to share, sometimes those things become less important. So that's really a gift, and I thank you all for that. And the one thing that I would want people to learn, that despite the kind of staunchiness and rules and that sort of thing, that it really is, you know, the pursuit of God through Roman Catholicism really is a love story. It is that how we become fully human, and becoming fully human, how we indeed touch the divine.
I would say the thing that I've learned from each of the panelists tonight, maybe are reinforced, you know, Deacon Peter talking about the Catholic faith, and one of the things I've always been amazed about is confession as it relates to the Catholic Church, and thinking through our sin and the confession piece. I've always been appreciative of that. And then from the Islamic faith, from Dr. Rabanny tonight, the commitment to pray 5 times daily. That's unbelievable. You know, and that, what a commitment to be that you know, consistent in 5 times a day of praying. From the Jewish faith, from Dr. Shanny, I appreciate the covenantal relationship of the Jewish people with God. I, I just think that is unbelievable, that that covenant relationship that God made way back when and continues that relationship with the his people. And then from the mainline Protestant, the diversity within the denomination that Mother Jane described. And I truly appreciate that diversity and an ability to get along, although extremely diverse. The thing that I would want people to know about Christianity is that many other world religions talk about an attempt on humanity's part to be accepted by God through works, through activity, through giving one's life, etc., to be accepted by God. But Christianity is really all about a relationship and Jesus Christ coming to earth and he being God coming in the flesh to make it possible to be, for us to be in relationship with God.
Actually, from today, in our Quran, Allah says about the Judaism and Christianity that in Islam, being a Muslim, we have to believe our previous scripture, like Torah and the New Testament, Old Testament, both. If we don't believe that one, just believe on Quran, we are not Muslim. So you have to believe that one. So this verse, actually, I see today is a implementation. From today's discussion, now I find that our scripture may be different, but we are actually cousin each other. That's my understanding from today's things. And for the audience, I cordially welcome all the audience who ever need more about the Islam beard. There are a lot of misconception. Our mosque is open to all, everyone, no matter what. You just call us and we can give time. Whatever your question, you can get the answer.
That's really nice. The thing I really enjoyed about this is the camaraderie and respect you all have for each other's religions and the openness to religions different than your own. And in my experience, that's more the norm, and it's not the way I think people often think about these religions. Sometimes the thing that often gets emphasized in religion is conflict and difference and holy war and crusades. But in fact, I think today, as well as throughout large swaths of history, Jews and Christians and Muslims have gotten along from and learned from each other and engaged in interreligious dialogue in all kinds of beautiful ways. And so I think it's been really enjoyable to be up here with you all and hearing your thoughts about other traditions and explaining your own.
Yes, yes, and yes.
So thin places are those places where, like, we meet God and see God. And, like, did you all notice that it's, like, happening right now? And so that's just been a really great gift, this ability to respect and have civil discourse and to see the God creation in one another and in all of you out there. And I guess what I would like you to know about the Episcopal Church or a takeaway is if you have doubt and if you have questions, hey, our doors are open because we don't profess to have all the questions, but we certainly hope to have the space to have the conversation.
Fantastic. Thank you. Let's give our panelists a big round of applause. I just want to thank all of you for coming out here and being part of this conversation. It was fantastic to see all of the questions from you, and there are still some. I will save them for next week when we continue our forum. Same time, same place. We encourage you to be here. We'll be talking more about the specific texts at that time. So make sure you think about that over the next week, and hopefully you'll be able to bring some great questions. And I'm going to turn it over to Eric now.
I also really want to just thank Melissa Langbehn. Thank you for doing such a great job. Let's give her a round of applause.
Thank you. Yeah.
These people. Thank you, and have a great night.